Irish socialist Republicans spoke with an activist called Red about anti-fascist work. We first asked them to talk about what goes into a successful anti-fascist campaign.
There's a lot that goes into that, but mass work is, again, at the center of our anti-fascist activity. It is, oh boy, where to start with this? Mass work is, again, at the center of this question. Because it's actually through, again, it's through relationships that we squeeze these guys. Our most successful anti-fascist work in so-called Seattle here that we get up to has been squeezing people socially. We do mass work and we get to know the neighborhood. We get to know people as individuals and we meet their needs and we connect them to people who can meet their needs and such as that. We have learned to thrive and navigate and move through social relationships. Fascists, they can't do this shit. Sorry, I'm not sure if I'm supposed to cuss. Sorry, my bad. But fascists can't do this stuff. They can't build like we can. And we build these fantastic invisible social networks by being cognizant of relationships and actively maintaining them over time. And we bring these forward as a punch without throwing a punch, as we say, by squeezing their social relationships. We tell their landlords about them. We get their local community stores to not sell them beer or cigarettes. We get stores of color to store owners of color and whatnot to put social pressure on them by denying them service. We organize all these various ways to put this social pressure on them, and it works. We don't have to confront them directly. We can absolutely make them lose their jobs, make them lose their homes, make them lose social credibility. We can make them unable to fill their own social needs. And so in a most direct sense, that's how we use mass work to throw a punch without punching and fight without fighting. We don't have to go to their house and confront them. We go to the people who they depend on and pressure them into relieving them of their means of survival. And it forces them to go into a mode where they have to survive instead of attacking others. And it forces them into a defensive position. And fascists don't thrive in a defensive position. Fascists thrive in an offensive position, where they are attacking civilians or people who are ideologically unsuited to defend themselves against them, and such as that. They love soft bellies. And when you turn your community into something that's a little bit more scaly, or maybe with some spines, they fuck off. So, oh, sorry. They peace out to other pastures, and we just keep them on the run. And it's the same tactic that states use against insurgents all over the world. You just keep them moving, and it exhausts them, and they tap out. It exhausts their supporters, and their supporters tap out. It frustrates their teams, and their teams tap out. We just keep them moving. Everywhere they go, we find them, and we put social pressure on the people around them to deny them goods and services and to socially ostracize them, and they are defeated. They cannot get any work done. They can't make any kind of social connections that stand the test of time. They don't get comfortable in their own homes. They get anxious about being able to pay their bills, and it causes them, without any blood, to fall out of the fight without ever having a confrontation. We can destroy them. And that's what we focus on. And that's, we can build intelligence networks without building intelligence networks, because we're not building intelligence networks. We're just talking to our neighbors who say, yeah, so and so, I saw a Trump flag. And then the Trump flag disappears and nobody knows who did it. But it just, you know, we form these strong social relationships that resolve problems all of their own accord. And we don't have to put up any flyers. We don't have to do mass emails or phone zaps. We just go and talk to their coworkers quietly as people, because we've had a beer next to them at the bar, or we've shared a sandwich with them one time, or we organized with them in the past, whatever, we worked with them or something. We know all these people, and when we need to, we can utilize social relationships as a weapon as much as a shield. That's how mass work fits in with anti-fascism. It's actually a stronger weapon than six guys with bats and face masks. It's much more powerful. It's much more efficient. And it gives the police no targets to attack, more importantly. It gives no opening for, police repression. And it takes a lot longer to implement. And it's not always super successful, which leaves room for the six guys with bats to still exist. But we find increasingly more creative ways to make their lives a living hell, and prevent them from doing antisocial work, through mass work, which gives us the tools to do that.
We next ask them what failure is in anti-fascist organizing.
Well, I mean, it depends on how you want to classify an unsuccessful anti-fascist campaign. You could argue that there's really no unsuccessful anti-fascist campaign from a certain point of view, because as long as people are fighting fascism, most people would consider that a success. From my point of view, the optimal victory is one that where you take no losses and you never expose yourself as the fighter. In any way whatsoever. You never expose yourself as the combatant. You win without fighting. You punch without punching, grasp without holding, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, right? It's all very Taoist. I think that any individualist, sort of attack on fascists that ends in police repression is a form of a failed action. I think that it is a failure of action. It is not a failed action. It's hard for me to use the word failure and anti-fascism together. Because I think that we live in fascist society, deeply fascist societies. And I think that anybody who clenches their fist to even raise it against a fascist, even if they don't ultimately raise their fist or even throw the punch, is commendable. I try not to label anything as a failure, but I think that, there are failures of action, when it comes down to, like I said before, giving the state something to attack. I think if you give evil nothing to oppose, then it goes away, sort of. Not necessarily in the general sense, but, in the tactical sense, when there's no open enemy, I mean, who are they gonna shoot at? You can't shoot at a booby trap, you know, or whatever. You can't shoot at an ambush necessarily until it happens. And so, that's sort of how we think about it. If you do something and you're effective and take losses, it's still good, but we think it's a certain level of failure to have taken any losses at all. The way we view, militant, aggressive anti-fascism and militant, like, political violence in general is that it should be rude. We think that, all violence should be partaken only as a necessity. And when we do it, you should do it as a funeral procession. It's, all political violence we feel like is sort of right wing in a sense, not reactionary, but it's sort of the right wing of social activities. And we think that if it has to be employed, that it should be employed with grim necessity. I think that your formation, when it has to engage in political violence, should feel like a funeral. It should not be something that anybody looks forward to or views. Even though I joke about it a lot, I mean, on my Twitter account, I joke about political violence quite a lot. But that's my personal view on it. As a formation, politically, it has to be like a funeral. Even if we're punching a guy in the face, it should be like a funeral procession. It should not be something that we get excited about. Having found no other way to defeat somebody other than by cracking them in the face is sort of a failure of a fighter in our view. We should find longer, more lasting, and more effective and efficient means to defeat our enemies than cracking them across the face. Not to say that they shouldn't be cracked across the face. Full support to people cracking fascists across the face and over the head. No question there. Full 100% support. But for our formation, we feel like, for the long term, I think that developing our ability to develop more sophisticated means of not just rooting out, but then socially demolishing these people over a long period of time is more, I think, maybe more effective and more of a propaganda of the deed than, say, Richard Spencer getting punched in the face. Like when a fascist comes out and says, "I'm completely broke, I've been sued into the ground, this and that, blah blah blah, I'm dropping out," and they've been fighting for years into the ground and they're just burned at both ends, and they just can't even fight anymore. They've been tracked down, they've just been hounded by dogs for years or a decade, and they just say, "Fuck it, I can't take it anymore." That's more of a downer to the people watching than watching Richard Spencer get decked. I think that's more of a morale defeat than just getting decked in the face. Like people seeing their comrades or their ostensible comrades, right wing comrades, being just reduced and just reduced and just reduced in front of them. I mean, there's recordable proof that it just demoralizes these guys. We think that in the long term, fighting these sort of more sophisticated, more socially astute ways of attacking them are better, we think.
How does anti-fascism fit within the wider revolutionary movement?
It penetrates every context of our life over here. I mean, anti-fascism is one of those distinctly not revolutionary activities that it forms the basis of revolutionary activity. It is an absolute community defense against fascists and whatnot is absolutely necessary. But again, it is not the revolution. But there won't be any revolution without our ability to defend our communities from fascist violence. And so anti-fascism fits into revolution in the same manner that mass work does. By doing that very necessary work that, well, again, is not necessarily a revolutionary work, but makes the space for it. Community defense is one more of those mass work initiatives that makes the space and makes the platform for all of our revolutionary fight. It is literally the rear guard of the revolutionary struggle. It is the people who hang behind and protect the civilian columns and the home front people from terrorism and from political violence. That's not distinctly revolutionary. It's not attacking directly the social relationships that build up capitalism and keep us ensnared in enriching these fucking scoundrels. But it is, again, making it safe for folks to do the work that's necessary to move the struggle forward. And I think that's how anti-fascism works. And I think that if you're planning on building a vanguard, you have to be able to embrace, and work alongside these non-party organs who are going to, do that you have to learn to live in concert, in sympathy with these non-party organs that are this sort of pastiche of non-party organs that are going to crop up that won't be distinctly your ideology or use distinctly your, methodology, but they will be nonetheless very effective, crucial, absolutely vital. And that's kind of what we're building, is we're building a non-party organ that, is capable of working with a political party, but is totally capable of getting things done without that leadership. But then can graft itself onto, as an organ to a party that, that the people find appropriate for them. And we'll of course know about that because we are among the people constantly. And constantly in dialogue with them, as hopefully this new party would be. And so that would be the place where we meet. But that's, yeah, we believe there's a long ways off before parties are, anyway, we're getting off topic, but yeah, so anti-fascism, absolutely, once again, not revolutionary, but necessary for the revolution to move forward, because we have to protect our flanks. And that's essentially what on-the-ground community defense is protecting our soft flanks from outside attackers, so that we can continue our revolutionary work in whatever sense that you do that work in. Does that make sense?
We asked Red for any final words on anti-fascist organizing.
We have to keep in mind that anti-fascism work doesn't end on the street corner. It doesn't end at the music venue. It doesn't end, at the county line. It extends all the way to the state house. England and United States, France, Germany, all these states have their histories of genocide, their histories of concentration camps, their histories of enclosure and destruction and accumulation by violence. And the basis of this fascist moment that we are in now comes out of these unresolved fascist situations. In the past, it builds on those situations that were never rectified, and nobody was ever brought to account, and the wealth and power that was accumulated out of those things was never redistributed. And so part of anti-fascism work is looking in the direction of the people who were harmed by the long history of fascist, quasi-fascist, and capitalist violence in history, and think about how we approach those people, how we support them materially, ideologically, how we incorporate their critiques of our movements into our work, and how we include them in our work. So anti-fascism isn't simply knocking a bonehead over his bonehead. It also involves a lot of self-criticism. It involves a lot of honesty about our history and our position in the world. It involves a lot of self-education about the plight of and the absolute destruction and miseration that that our state receives a lot of power and wealth from, and that we receive some small part of our lives from. And so that all of our work, also we have to spend some time, some self-reflection in how it is that we begin to make restitution to the rest of the world for the history of violence that they've undergone as part of anti-fascist work. And if we're not thinking about that, for not thinking about explicitly about the people that were directly harmed, then we are doing, we're not completing the work. And so that's, I think that's the last note that I want to add, to the talk on fascism for sure. I just, want to make sure that we're keeping that in mind.